All right, 3, 2, 1.
You are witnessing the ultimate miniaturization of the cassette player, the creation of microcircuitry, the smallest motor of its kind, the reinvention of the wheel, the chassis, the case. You are witnessing the birth of the Super Walkman from Sony.
Hey everyone, you're listening to the Sixth World Podcast, a roundtable discussion podcast where we talk about our favorite RPG Shadowrun. Today's executive producer for the show is Jacob Heid and James O'Neill for this month, patrons over there at Patreon. Thank you guys so much. And my name is Bobby Frankenberger. I'm joined, as always, by my co-host, CASSIE Levitt. How's it going, CASSIE?
It's good.
Coming to us live from New York City.
Yeah, around the west side of Manhattan.
Nice! I've never been to New York. Or New York City. Do New Yorkers, do you think they, like, people from New York City or New York State, do they get annoyed that people might, like, conflate the two?
Probably, yeah.
I feel like that's a thing New Yorkers would be annoyed about. Our guests today are from two very popular online Shadowrun play communities. We've got Justin, I don't even know how I would say your Reddit username, Nitsuj.
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 Just my name backwards.
He's from. He's from ShadowNet, and Alex, or Why Contain It, from the RunnerHub. Welcome to the show, guys.
Hello, hello. Thank you for having us.
Thank you, indeed.
Yeah, of course, because today, later in the show, for the main topic of our show, we're going to be talking about, you know, finding groups and finding ways and people to play with online. So who better to have on the show to talk to us about that than people from your online play communities? So, but we'll talk a bunch more about those later. First, before all that, it is the... CASSIE, do you realize this? It is the 8th episode of the Sixth World Podcast.
I know. We're doing quite well for ourselves here.
And I'm making a big deal of that because I figure, why the hell not? Why do we have to wait until 10 or 100? Like, you know, why does it have to be the decimal number system?
It's the last one of the year.
There you go. Yeah. There's another special thing about it, the last one of the year. So I'm thinking binary. We should have binary milestones starting here at number 8.
Oh, yeah.
That's 2 to
go
the 3rd.
Of 2.
Yeah, exactly. The next one, 2 to the 4th, we'll go with episode 16. We'll have a big blowout party.
Okay.
It's going to get harder and harder, though. That's how exponential growth works.
It'll be
32 after that, then 64, and we won't make it to 128 probably. So.
Oh, no, we got this. That's quitter talk.
Yeah.
What you need to do is you need to say what you're going to do for your 128th one really publicly so that you'll be really embarrassed if you fail.
Yeah, we're going.
Who doesn't work good with that kind of crucible hung around their
head? After that many episodes, we might be comfortable enough to talk about CFD.
Yeah, to finally talk about CFD, the topic that everybody agrees
exactly.
on.
We'll just do the MCT method of motivation, and if you don't make it to episode 128, you'll be expected to commit seppuku.
Maybe we should stick with that decimal thing. So it's the end of the year, as you mentioned, CASSIE, the last episode of the year, and speaking of end of the year things, there's a little thing that Shadowrun podcasters and content creators like to do every year. We do this sort of end of the year simulcast where we all get together and make a big episode together talking about things that have happened that year, plans we have for the future, and just talking about Shadowrun. It's kind of like the one time we take to just get together, hang out, and everybody posts it on their various feeds. So that is going to be on January. It's not in January. I'm lying. Don't listen. It's actually tomorrow as of the time we're recording this. So December 30th. So if you're in the live, if you're in the chat room, you'll hear this ahead of time. It's also been all over Twitter and Facebook and stuff. I've been putting it everywhere. So you guys should head out there. We're going to go live. That's another thing that's new this year. It's going to be live streamed. We're actually going to stream it live from the Sixth World Podcast channel right here on Twitch. And but you'll be able to catch it later. If you're listening to this and you're hearing about it for the first time, like on the podcast feed, then you already missed it. But you'll be able to catch it on various feeds on the different podcasts you listen to. In fact, this very feed that you're listening to this episode on. So should be a lot of fun. And I'm hosting it. I'm a little nervous about that. But
it'll be good.
Yeah, I hope it will.
how many people we got?
I think we have 8 podcasters, maybe 9. I think we have 8 that are going to be there. So we'll see how it goes. I'm looking forward to it. CASSIE, you were telling me about how you've started kind of cracking the whip on yourself. What is that, like a flail? Self-flagellation. I don't know where this is going. Let's just abort.
Okay.
You're starting to write down stuff you were telling me about?
Yeah, I was just something about wanting more run ideas. And I think something like that, like last episode. So I have actually started finally taking the time to write down outlines for my runs. Trying to do them based on like the Shadowrun Anarchy layout, so it's just like one page.
Oh, nice!
One quick stuff.
So like quick write-ups of your adventures.
Yeah, exactly. So hopefully I get those out and can start throwing them out there for people.
Oh, that would be cool. We should put. That's we should goal. Make a page on our website for people to get stuff.
Might do that. Yeah, if I've written 3 so far, so if I can get more of them written down.
Nice.
Throw them out there.
That's cool. I know I was having a conversation with you about it when you were telling me earlier, and I was telling you I never write things down, and I'm really bad at that. Justin, are you good at it? Writing stuff down after the fact?
I kind of have to be with the fact the way, like, when I'm doing stuff with the ShadowNet, we have to because of the way GMs have to submit AARs after every run they do.
Right. AARs,
even if it's a small
after
one.
Action reports.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Just, especially because of like anything that affects like the lore, the meta plot,
or
the city state or power structure has to be annotated, or even if it's something specific to players. So it's kind of like being in that habit has helped me with like home games. So.
Yeah,
that's cool.
I really still do that over the grid too, and it's really, as you said, it's really good more for myself than if anyone else is reading it, because I'll forget about that stuff and then come back to it in a week and be like, what did we do? I remember something happened.
Yeah, I think it's an action that definitely helps GMs more than just be needless, you know, fodder for, you know, the GM division.
Yeah, and I don't know if you do this, but like on mine, because all of ours are public, and so if I get to the end of a run series, I'll put in all of the things that happened afterwards, because you forget stuff after a few months to be like, oh, what was this dude and what was he doing? Like, what was the overall story that you didn't tell the players? And so I'll list out like the entire like motivations of the NPCs and stuff like that, so people can see the whole story that usually gets stuck just in the GM's head.
Yeah, I know what you mean. Or like I'll plan. I used to plan everything from like scratch, but then the first time I planned this really intricate matrix run, this was back in like third edition, and I mean I plotted everything out. I spent like an entire week every day after school like plotting this out. And then the first run, they didn't even do anything in the matrix. They just went complete pink mohawk and they killed an NPC I spent forever designing, and I was like, well, that's, I'm never doing that again.
Alex, yeah. I assume that you're the same way. You guys have after action reports and you must be practiced at it.
We do. I actually do not GM on the hub, but I do GM for my home games. I'm going to GM for the hub when I get around to it.
Yeah.
But so far, I've had a busy schedule with my home games and stuff, including kicking off a Hunter the Vigil one.
And do you keep lots of post-adventure notes?
What I like to do is when something the players does catches my eye, I just kind of, I have a little, the Windows 7 post-it note thing up, I just throw something down on it about it. And then every once in a while, when it seems like something's going a little slower in another one, I'll take a look back at that and I'll be like, I'm just going to choose something to have show up again.
Right. Yeah. No, it's something I need to get better at. That's definitely for sure. Everybody is much better at me than that. But I want to hit some of the news real quick before we get to the main topic here. So let's do that.
World news today.
There's not a lot really super news kind of, but I did notice a couple of things that I thought were cool. Both of them kind of related. The first one is I caught somewhere in some feed somewhere that it was a Game Informer article that of the top tabletop games of 2016. I'll put this link in the chat there. The top tabletop games of 2016 and Shadowrun Anarchy made their list. So I thought that was pretty neat to see something of our stuff in there.
Did you Good.
Oh no, I was just gonna say, like, considering that Shadowrun has always been a setting that people in the general gaming community has always been like, wow, that's a really interesting setting, but because of it's so crunch heavy, it's steered a lot of people away. And I think Anarchy made a lot of steps towards bridging that gap.
Hopefully.
Yes. So it's well earned.
Somebody recently wrote a review, and I can't remember where that was. That was at StufferShack.com. There was a review on Anarchy. I think they played through the whole book, like all the missions in it. They, when I read through it, I'm like, I want to go play Anarchy now. Why am I doing all this crunchy stuff?
That's
it looks like it was them.
That's
It was like, it was just something like, oh, it was so nice to be able to get through a story and not have to deal with drain or this and just like all the rules. I'm like, oh, yeah, I guess that would be nice not to do all that stuff.
The thing with Shadowrun is all the rules serve a purpose, but there's a lot of them. Like, there's a lot. I don't think I've ever gone through a full session of Shadowrun without having to look up at least one rule.
Yeah.
Yeah. It definitely used to be in a better habit of just making a call because I didn't know the rules. And the more I started to learn the rules, the more I try to use the real ones.
We're spoiled by PDFs. The PDF has spoiled us. It's too easy to control F now.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Another, the other news thing, similar related is I saw, are you guys familiar with that, website Ranker?
Mm-mm.
Yes.
Yeah. So it's this. It's this website, and it's basically they rank things. It sounds weird, but it's they just make lists of things and have a bunch of people go on there and rank them, whether they like them or not, and things get ranked in an order of whatever. And so they had one recently, which was the greatest pen and paper RPGs ever. And some of these pop up sometimes of ranker polls about RPGs. But usually Shadowrun is not number one, and it was on this one. So I thought that was cool too.
That's interesting. I wouldn't expect that. I would always imagine that D&D would beat it out.
Like, now here's the thing:
like that.
If you go and look at this again, I put a link, and there'll be a link in the show notes. But if you go and look at this, at least at the time of this recording, it's at number one. And you'll notice that there's a lot more votes for things like Dungeons & Dragons than there are for Shadowrun. And the ratio of likes, of upvotes to downvotes, is a lot higher on Dungeons & Dragons. So you might be wondering, why in the hell then is Shadowrun number one if the ratio is not larger? But I did a lot of digging into this, and apparently the way that Ranker's algorithm works is it puts some... it puts some weight on a thing that they call re-ranks. And what that is people can just go onto this thing and click like the up arrow and the down arrow and different things to say whether they like it or dislike it. And that affects the votes and where the rank is. But you can also go in there and re-rank the list. Like you click on the button and you get all the things that are on the list and you put them in the order that you think they should be in. And I guess what they think is that the people who are going to take the time to do that are what they call like power users. And I guess their thought process is that those people might be like, I guess if you're like super passionate and into this hobby or whatever it is, and you're a power user, then maybe your opinion matters more. I don't know. So full disclosure, mm-hmm. Shadowrun might not be the best. It just might be that those like neckbeardy people who think they know everything about RPGs all play Shadowrun.
I was curious if it was the margin of difference between the people who don't like it versus the votes.
I could do math real fast, but I'm not going to. It's something like 60-65% if I'm glancing at it are upvotes for it. So
I mean, I'll be honest, I'll always take a dice pool based system over single d20 systems.
Yeah.
Oh, paranoia is number 13. We got to work on that, Bobby.
All right. I think you can vote more than
so good.
I think you can vote.
Is Riff
often?
Is Riff's on that list? Probably not.
Riff's. This is actually a really cool list. This is. Yep, it is number 28.
It belongs lower than that, just because it's a D. It's a percentile system.
Yeah.
Oh no, that sounds awful. No.
Yeah. Percentile is the worst way to go.
I have to see Dungeons & Dragons, the different versions a little better on here multiple times.
Yeah, that's true, and perhaps that's influenced its ranking. I don't know. I'm going to close it, though, because all the advertisements on there are, like, slowing my computer down.
Yeah, and now I'm just clicking on buttons. I need to get back to the show.
So check those out. There's, like I said, not a lot of super news stuff going on, but what we do have going on, like we do in every episode, is our Q&A. Do I have a bumper for this? I'll just play something random here. This never goes badly. There you go. Let's do Q&A.
Oh, okay, that's my job.
I almost clicked on one of the CASSIE audio clips that I have that she hates when I click on. So every episode we like to answer questions that are sent to us at our website, sixworldpodcast.com. We've got a forum on there that people can submit questions that we answer on the show. Is also, if you don't want to do that, you want to email us, there's theshow@sixworldpodcast.com, or you can send us questions via Twitter @sixworldpodcast. That's the number 6 World Podcast. Our first question comes from Scott Flowers. Oh, before I continue asking questions, another thing, since we're talking about Patreon nowadays, if you want to have, if you want your question to have a better chance of being answered on the show, then patrons get that benefit. So head on over to patreon.com/sixthworldpodcast and check that out. We got all sorts of other cool things there. Anyway, Scott Flowers asks us, as a GM, would you allow a player to use the dependence negative quality for needy/destructive mundane pets? For example, a PC could get incessant matrix notices from their home of their cat knocking over and breaking things out of boredom when they're in the middle of a run. If so, in your opinion, how many cats would a crazy cat lady PC need to adequately represent each rank of the dependence quality? I put this in there because I love this question.
So good, right? Yeah, like 100%. Like, right? Does anyone disagree? Yeah, a pet wouldn't fall under dependence. They mentioned at the beginning of Howling Shadows a lot of fluff about the reasons wage slaves don't have pets, and it has a lot to do with that. Like, they don't have time for it. And the dependence quality, particularly, has a condition related to time, right? So I think it would definitely fall into that. Mm-hmm. I once had an NPC who was a crazy cat lady, toxic shaman. She had 6 cats. I would say at least 5 would be a crazy cat lady level, or one para slash techno critter.
What about you, Alex?
Needs.
How many cats do you need to qualify for the quality, Alex?
I'd say that depends on how disruptive they are. Because the whole point of the dependence negative is that they're not just someone you have an obligation to, but they're also time consuming.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Pets are time consuming if you have
one.
Oh,
man. I'd love to take this run, but I've got a vet appointment that day.
Can you use Prank Warrior for techno critters?
Remind me, what is Prank Warrior?
So Prank Warrior is a negative from data trails that basically means that there's some sort of matrix entity, which can be another hacker or it can be a sprite or an AI or whatever, that just likes to mess with you because they think it's funny or because you have a rivalry or something like that. So that's I would love to see bodies. Someone like a Decker or something with a techno critter pet that tries to outwit them. That would be amazing.
No, even better, like just twist it a little bit and just whenever you're fitzing around in the matrix trying to put your marks on things, you know, your little techno cat is like batting away at your marks and knocking them off onto the ground.
Or just sending you like coupons for different foodstuffs that it wants.
And that never forget the moment of dread that your Decker experiences when you say the words, "You have a mark on you," in the middle of something.
It's your pet.
And
your
then you just kind of pause and you go, "It's your cat again."
I love that idea. I think we're all in agreement, Scott Flowers, that that yes, absolutely your pets. Mm-hmm. But yeah. I think the number of pets that you have is less important than, like Alex said, the degree to which whatever the collective unit of your pets is annoying the crap out of you on a constant basis, or taking up your time,
especially during runs.
Yeah, yeah. Your suggestion, Scott, of having them send you messages in the middle of a run and knocking stuff. Like, I like that take on it, you know, like your coffee machine sends you a message saying that it needs repairs in the middle of a run because it just got knocked onto the floor.
By the cat,
yeah.
If you've never seen the game Cat Lateral Damage, that's what I'm thinking of right now. Put all your stuff's tagged,
yes.
And so it's sending you messages. It's knocking stuff up.
Our next question is from Ocule, I think would be how you pronounce that. Ocule. It's one of our on one of
I guess
our
Ocule?
YouTube Ocule. Yeah. On our YouTube channel said, so with a group of new players, I'm the only one with the Shadowrun experience. Would you recommend starting the group on Anarchy or starting them on Vanilla? I want to hear.
Somebody else want to share? Justin, you get an opinion on that?
What do you think, Justin?
Yeah, I've actually been this person multiple times, and it depends on how comfortable you personally are with the setting. Because if you can make characters for them, you can just go in, and if that's what you want to do. However, if you're more interested in just experiencing the world and the setting and the lore, and you don't want to get bogged down with the minutia of all the gear and everything that kind of comes with that, then yeah, pick up Anarchy, you know, but it's really going to depend on you as the person with the experience is what you want to commit to, because you're probably going to also end up being the person that GMs. So it's really on you.
I would think to your players, right? So if you're used to crunchy systems or you come from a big D&D background, you know, picking up, going straight to like core fifth edition wouldn't be worse because you know, you kind of have that familiarity, but if this is the first RPG you've ever played, Anarchy would be the way to go, right?
No.
Another thing would be how familiar they are with not just the setting, but how to play with the things in the setting, because core Shadowrun has a lot of stuff that you can do some really wild things with if you start combining the stuff from different books. Like,
sure.
There are all the tricks with DMSO and stuff, or using gamma scopolamine to interrogate someone and stuff like that. And a lot of that stuff they wouldn't really think of unless in Anarchy, unless it was brought up to them.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas in the Shadowrun 5th stuff, it's like, here are some, you've got your core book and about 8 splats worth of toolkits of stuff to play with. Go nuts.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I would say
yeah.
the only thing that I'd find a little bit hard for Anarchy if you're playing with people who've never played an RPG anymore is that whole like set with like plot points and them narrating the story. Like if you've never yep. played an RPG, yeah. that could be a little tough for somebody.
Yeah, and I was going to say, you know, CASSIE, that I took small issue with what you said about the first one before, because Shadowrun really was my first real RPG. So, like that was my introduction to tabletop RPGs, and I loved it. And I think it has a lot more to do with the style of play that your players want. Yeah. And if they're the type of people that just want to sit around and tell stories and joke about this, that, and, you know, like if they like that sort of thing, then sure, Anarchy is a really good way to go. But if they're the type of people who like, maybe they lean more towards simulationist type games, maybe they're like, maybe they come from Battletech or something. You know, games that require a lot of that, you know, numbers and what, if they're the type of people who like that, then skip the, there's, I'm starting, the more I think about Anarchy, to not like the thought process of Anarchy introducing people to Shadowrun.
Yeah, it's because they didn't design it that way. They designed it to kind of be its own separate thing.
Well, we
could
talk all day about
play along.
That, but
I do think it might be a good introduction to the setting.
Sure, that's yeah. fair. That's fair.
You would have. It's one of those things where you have to make sure that everyone has actually read the stuff about it.
Yeah. Yeah, that's a good point, because another thing I was going to say is that another consideration is, do you think that you guys are going to want to play sort of a one shot or want to do a more long-term campaign? Because I think that Anarchy is good for one shots, really well suited for that. And I don't want to imply that you can't use it to do a long-term campaign. Certainly you can, but I personally think that vanilla core Shadowrun rules are SR5 is that's where it shines, the ability to build your character, customize it, really take it far, and the GM has a lot yeah. to work with, and I think yeah. you can, I think the rules, the crunch actually enables you to build a rich world. So
you can always get food fight too if you want to do
that's true.
Instead of doing
Yeah.
And I think it's a great introduction. Like, you just make it so this is your introduction to the rules and the setting, and it does a really good job of being like a snapshot of mm-hmm. Shadowrun in Seattle.
Food fight yeah. is the eternal best.
Yeah. It's
I ran
it's
it
good.
So many times.
Yeah.
I would like, say the only suggestion I would have if you're gonna run vanilla 5th edition for brand new players is to stick with core. And maybe one or two other supplements. Like, I wouldn't introduce somebody to all of them right out the gate.
Yeah.
I would say I'd probably shut out most of the run faster generation options.
Yeah. Well,
except for maybe
run faster and running gun are kind of the two that add a bulk of extra stuff onto what is already there.
I
like data trails
gun.
And rigor 5 kind of just clarify stuff that already existed.
Like, I'd be cool with Run and Gun because that has a lot of fun toys for the street Sams mm-hmm. who otherwise are, they tend to be very straightforward, but yeah. then you give them the small unit tactics thing and they have this fun toolkit where they can go and be like, I want to be an operator.
Right. I would think I would probably exclude a lot of the Run and Gun stuff to start with only because it does add a ton more mechanics.
Yeah, I would tell them, like, don't
fun,
worry about
but...
all the new called shots for now. Don't worry.
Yeah, that's
the only one you
down.
Need to know is Bullseye Burst.
Like, right. if you want to do the martial arts and stuff, that to me adds a lot of fun to it. But yeah, I would cut out a lot of the mechanics stuff. Anyway,
you have to allow Chrome Flesh if for no other reason than because Narco is the best augmentation.
Chrome
ever.
Flesh definitely opens up a lot of possibilities to your augmentation-based characters. And I would say Street Grimoire makes the magic system for your mages and your adepts much richer.
That's true. Yeah, the traditions are so good.
They are. I would say, though, that someone who is very new to the setting would probably be best served themselves by sticking to Hermetic or Shamanic, just because those are so central to the system and to the setting.
Yep. I totally agree. So I hope we answered your question, guys. Remember, if you want to send some more questions to us, anybody, do that at the website or at the, you know, just go to the website.
one last thing that I'll say on that is if you're starting with the core fifth sort of thing, probably don't be too harsh on them with stuff like, oh, I forgot to buy a lockpick kit to go with my locksmithing skill because I didn't realize I needed it. Stuff like that. Just be like, sure, you have your basic stuff.
Yeah, that's a really good point, especially people new to it. All right, well, on to our main topic. Whoa! Nice. Did I wake you guys up? guys, we're going to be talking about finding ways and people to play with online and how we do that. And this is a topic that's kind of near and dear to me because I've been playing Shadowrun since I was in middle school, since like the early, I was not in middle school in the early 90s, and since like the mid 90s. I started with second edition, and I think it was, I don't know anymore, but the point is I've been playing for a while, and then I took a long break and I played with the same couple of people forever. And I took a long break after college and everything, and I really wanted to get back into Shadowrun, and we'd all separated, and I had, you know, children, and I had no time to go to the local game store and find a group, and around here they don't play too much Shadowrun at that game store anyway. But the point is, I discovered groups of people to play with online, and I wouldn't be where I am today if it wasn't for the way that we can connect with people now and play online. And still, even today, still I see questions pop up on podcasts, people sending us questions on you know, the Facebook group, on Twitter, on Reddit, people constantly asking, how in the world do I find people to play with online on Shadowrun? And I think I know a lot about it, and maybe we need to help other people. So why don't we just jump right into, so we can get it out of the way, and have each of you introduce your various, you know, talk about the you guys' communities to play with online, because I think they're amazing and very cool. So let's start with Justin. And you can tell us a little bit about ShadowNet.
All right. Yeah. So ShadowNet, similar to the Hub, is a Reddit-based, Reddit and Discord-based group, collective of players and GMs alike. And like the mission statement for the net is to ensure like the maximum amount of players that can enjoy Shadowrun together in the simplest and most accessible format possible. And what that means is we tend to stray far away from home rolling things. Mm-hmm. We try to stick to raw as much as possible, and also allowing GMs to have as much autonomy over their tables as possible with just kind of like the loose threads of our meta plot and stuff like that connecting all the different tables. Plus we have like active, like in character role play that goes on our Discord, because mm-hmm. that's how we do all our voice and our chats, and how you can get help for building characters and your rules questions, and, you know, getting, if you're a new GM, how to get help, you know, that type of a thing.
Yeah. Now, ShadowNet is, for those who might not be familiar, I heard somebody describe it this way not too long ago. It's the same for RunnerHub, actually. Both of you guys are, so I heard someone refer to them as Shadow, like a Shadowrun pickup group community. And I liked that description, because it kind of like in a really pithy way described exactly what I think the key unique thing about, I guess it's not unique is not a good word, because you've got two different ones, but The cool thing about those communities is you can get in and you don't necessarily have to find, you know, four or five other people who are going to be available to play with you on X day of the week, this many times a month, forever, and launch a campaign and everything. You jump in, you know, get a character made, get it approved, and you can just look for games that are convenient for you whenever you have free time and stuff like that, or even run your own games. That's true, right?
Yes. Yep. We try to make it as simple as possible. We try to limit the amount of requirements to do things on the net, because when you get new people, you want to make sure, especially with, like, when you have a group that has like 100 or 200 people. I think we currently have actively about 200 people on ShadowNet. Mm-hmm. So when you have that, like, there has to be structure, but we don't want people to be like, you know, you have to play 20 games before you can possibly GM. For us, sure. It's just, you come, you play three games, and then you can apply to be a GM. And yeah, we try to make our strictures as loose as possible to give people as much freedom in play. And you're absolutely right. Like, the core thing that kind of connects us and the hub is that, you know, it's a pickup inspired. Like, you can do character developments, you can have like ongoing plot threads, but the ongoing plot threads tend to be more specific to like GMs that have, I'm going to do this series of runs. And you probably won't have like the same runners, which in my opinion fits the system, the setting more, because imagine a Johnson that's got like this long drawn out plan. They're probably not going to use the same shadow runners over and over again, because right. That means they're going to know more information, and you want to keep that stuff, you know, segmented, kind of like terrorist yeah. cells.
And they stop being so deniable once they've seen three different parts yeah. of your plan.
Yeah, right. Exactly.
Exactly.
And Alex, so there's I'm sorry, Justin, keep going.
Oh, no, I was just going to say, like, that aspect to it, like, we really emphasize it on the net, and I think the hub does, too, in, you know, their own way, is, like, you know, you are really just a small little portion.
You're a cog.
It really, right. Yeah, you are the cog, and it's really, you know, that's kind of the feeling you get unique as opposed to playing in like a home game.
Right. That touches on something else that I wanted to talk about. And I know about ShadowNet and RunnerHub both. And maybe Alex, you can speak a little bit to this, that you guys, to some degree, at least it's built on this like shared world within your respective communities. Anyway, you have this kind of, what's the word I'm looking for? It's like a continuous.
The term that we use is living world.
There you go. That's a good way to put it.
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah. We
like the idea there is that you have this setting, basically. You know, we all use Seattle because it's the default. Mm-hmm. And what you have is a world that moves on whether you do stuff or not. And you are able to participate in it. And sometimes you're able to make changes, and things happen based on the things you do. But everyone else out there has their own motivations and their own desires that they're pursuing. And those are all set pieces that you are interacting with. And you, in turn, are a set piece for everyone else.
And I really, that's when I first heard about RunnerHub and ShadowNet, that's the thing that really stuck out to me, because Like when you're playing in your home game in a campaign, you can often get this false kind of sense that you are, well, you know, you're the, it's not really a false sense, but you're the star of your own story, right?
Yeah.
I mean, that's the way it is. But you kind of sometimes lose sight of the fact that you are one small, tiny, insignificant story in this large world. And it seems to me like that's the cool thing about this living world, as you put it, that everybody shares in, is that you just ran this run, but there's all these other people who did stuff that same night that are affecting other parts of the world. And, you know, you're like, I think you said, Justin, you're just a small, tiny, insignificant part. And well, that sounds like so negative. That's a theme of Shadowrun,
that's,
right?
Yeah, especially cyberpunk. Like that's a very central
it's
idea.
It's part of the whole dystopian ideal. Exactly. Is that this whole system has gotten so out of control that no one person could stop it if they tried.
Sure.
Yeah.
And it's cool that you guys... I'm sorry, Cassie, go ahead.
I'll say a fun thing I had while GMing in this kind of Mind 6-7 Emerald Grid, and I used to be a GM on the Runner Hub, is you can do a simple run, and maybe you just think it's going to be a one-shot, and then your players will take that to whatever role-playing forum they have, whether it's a Reddit thread or something like that, and they'll start sharing details that you maybe not even planned or even thought of.
Yeah.
And then from that, you might find the inspiration to do another one, and those players will also share in this story, and you can end up with, like, several dozen people who have now all shared in this story and are helping you write it. It's
it's kind of amazing that you, yeah, it's like planting seeds. Like every time, like I've done several runs as a GM on the net where I did it as just like a one shot. I was like, I'll do this as just a fun little thing with the people that sign up. And then a player was like, I really like that. So when I GM a game, I'm going to use an aspect of that. And then it builds off of that. And so, yeah. I mean, that's how like, meta plots in the past have kind of come like, you know, the previous meta plots that we've done that the net has accrued over time.
Yeah, sure. Definitely one run series we did was, and it was just actually not even on a table. It was just some fun, like, in-character RP I was doing with a player on Discord, and they just did something that didn't make a lot of sense. So I got another player involved, and we had the scene with them. And then from that, I took it over to two other GMs. And one of them ran a social hour, and essentially we set off a bomb in the middle of, like, these people hanging out in a bar.
Was telling me about that.
Yeah, I think we ended up with, like, a dozen people on a table, and everyone's character just kind of ended the scene where Yonkers was one of the characters. He, you know, was just driving up to the bar, and then he's just standing outside, and he sees, like, the bar is partially exploded, and the cops are everywhere, you know, so... And it was just suddenly like, we had two other mages who flew in astral, you know. So it was kind of fun to see, like, how you can get that interaction between GMs. Because it'll surprise players, right? Like, GMs will know, or I mean, a player will know that, oh, I was on this GM's table, and the storyline's happening there. But if you can get another GM to take that little seed and start running with it there, you'll surprise them.
Yeah. Yeah, it's really a neat thing. One of the other things that it seems simple, especially to someone who's familiar with both ShadowNet and RunnerHub and how they work. It seems simple, but for someone who's hearing about this for the first time, one thing that I think definitely should be emphasized about your community is for someone who's looking to play Shadowrun and doesn't know how to get started online, is that one of the things that really appealed to me hearing about it as a stay-at-home dad who has a very crazy schedule and sometimes can't commit to a once a week kind of thing. It's that pickup group aspect to it. Your respective communities, like I often just get some free time in the evening and like, oh, this evening is going to be free and I could play something. And so you can jump on there and you can check to see if there are any games going on, or you know that 2 days from now you're going to be free and you can check to see if anybody's going to be running a game and you can try to get involved.
100%. Yeah. I mean, that's what's drawn me, like, especially as like a father and a full-time job, sure, and stuff like that. Like I can't always like play like a constant week by week game. So like, I'll be like, oh, this weekend I don't have any big plans, so I'll plan a run or whatever.
Yeah, and the worst thing is, even if you think you're going to be able to do something once a week, is to know that your schedule, and especially having young kids, like I know you do, Justin, and I do as well, you never know what's going to happen, and you hate to be the guy who's got to cancel on everybody and stuff like that.
Yeah, there's been a few times, like, right after my daughter was born, like, you know, even I, you know, something would happen and be like, sorry guys, I gotta bow out.
But it can be nice as the GM that if you lose a player, it's usually easy enough to replace them with somebody else.
Easy to pick up a replacement.
We start running too far, do you want to introduce the Runner Hub?
I'm sorry about that. So, Alex, tell us about the
Runner
Hub.
It's the big one. So
so that's the Reddit community is reddit.com/r/runnerhub. It has something like 2,000 people subscribed. I couldn't tell you how many are actually active players, but I've never seen a game have difficulty filling up with the number of people it needed. So like I said earlier, the whole living world thing. So I'll skip over that part because I feel like that got covered adequately. And like Justin said with ShadowNet, if you want to be a GM, you just play in three games, get a feel for the local culture, basically.
Yeah.
And you throw in a little app, an example of a run that you'd like to do. And we have an interview team who will talk about it with you, be like, okay, you know, and then if you ever have any trouble with the system or with the setting or whatever, we've got a little GM chat in Skype and possibly in Discord if we can convince people to move over, where we've got a ton of the more experienced GMs and mm-hmm. the members of the thematic division is what it's called, which is basically a group of volunteers who know a lot about the setting and will provide advice about it. And you can get those people to tell you anything that you need to know. So you can be like, hey, you know, I want to have a run in Renton and I want a gang to mess with the runners if they do this thing at this time. Mm-hmm. Who would be a good group to have do that? And they'll be like, okay, you could use these guys. Those are the local powerhouses there. Or you cool. can be like, okay, we have this kind of facility. What kind of defenses would they have? And they'd be like, okay, well, it's a little too small to have an on-site mage, but what they might do is they might have the FAB lining the windowsills to see if people are trying to sneak it invisible, because it's super right. cheap to do that. Stuff like that. So we have what I would say is a pretty robust support network for people who want to learn more about it and who want to participate. That's in addition really cool. to that, it's really easy to just submit a character, get it gone over as far as its mechanical validity and its thematic appropriateness, so that we don't have someone trying to like apply Chewbacca and then
right.
No, you laugh, but someone tried that.
Well, and RunnerHub's been around for what? You going in 3 years, or did you just finish?
Sounds
3 years?
About right.
So
I
something
think
like
it's
that.
Three, two and a half,
I thought
or
it
three.
Was more.
Yeah.
Yeah, I thought it was more, but yeah.
And then the big thing that I think is, it's a good introduction for a lot of people who are used to playing at cons is RunnerHub does a lot of the rules mission style. No, it's not exactly, but a lot. It'll have a much more similar rule set to missions, which a lot of people, I think, find comfortable if they're come from that convention center sure. background.
Yeah,
for the most part, we try to stick to rules as written, except where they're not really appropriate or functional for the format.
Yeah.
For one reason or another, like, we have day job taken out because it's basically free income a lot of the time for people.
Right.
And
right.
it's super hard to keep track of when it's not yeah. in a home game.
Bookkeeping. That's like the same thing with us. Like we have a lot less like band qualities than the hub, but we still have like ones that are bookkeeping nightmares where it would be fine in a home game where it's one GM who's got four players constantly, but in a group where there's, I think we have like 1,000-something subscribers and you know, it's like impossible to keep track of. So
there's just stuff you can't track.
There are a number of qualities too that definitely require, like, I think, is it tough and targeted particularly is a good one where it's like it really requires GM input. You know what I mean? Or like a GM needs to be kind of personally involved with that quality. I can't think of another good one off the top of my head, but they're out there.
Yeah, and that makes sense, you know, being that it's not you're not participating in an ongoing campaign with a single group, people that are getting to know each other and character backstory and all that kind of stuff. There are going to be certain things that don't work, you know?
Yeah. And I think both communities allow for once you've progressed as a player, allow for three characters each. Is that, it might be different
five.
On the net. Five. Okay.
It used to be three, but we had like a prime slot. But yeah. Prime slot essentially became retirement, semi-retirement, because you could only play in Prime games. So we removed mm-hmm. that, added an extra one, because we also allow for some to 10, so you can have up to 5.
Okay.
Yeah. Like, I'm looking at a few of the band qualities from the RunnerHub, and it's stuff like tough and targeted. Wanted is banned at character creation, but it can be assigned if you do really, really fucked up stuff during a run.
Yeah,
right.
I always appreciated that on the hub. A lot of the band qualities were still assigned during in play. You wouldn't start out with them per se, but
yeah, like there was the time that some people gassed a Make-A-Wish Foundation event.
Oh god,
that got some people like
one
three
quality.
Of them retired and one got wanted.
Yeah, I remember that.
And it's like you don't say.
Yeah, well, I hope so. Alex, yeah. Justin mentioned that they have a Discord channel. What are the ways that you guys, aside from Reddit, of course, communicate with each other? Do you have anything like that?
We do. RunnerHub has an official Discord and a... I can't remember if it's official or not, but a Skype channel.
Yeah.
Yeah, I think it was official back in the day. They used to do everything on Skype, right? But you're moving to Discord or trying to transition.
I was about to say, that's got to be unwieldy.
Just
gotta
be the hard one. That's what we did. You just got to be like, we're like, in a month, we're switching over and this is gone. So
shutting it down.
To this day. That's right. What we did. We were just like, we had the vote and be like, should we make the move? The vote passed. And we were like, we're going to move. And that was kind of the end of it.
Cut the cord.
Yeah, now we just have both of them active.
Yeah.
To throw a little out there before, because we'll probably get to the end of this and I'll forget, is the other option you can really do to find online games is using Roll20.
Yes, I was going to segue to that, so perfect segue.
Doing like the find games menu option, in my experience, it doesn't work that well. I've not found a lot of games and then went to it and posted and actually got a lot of responses. The best way I always found games on there is to go to Roll20 and the community and then go to the looking for group forum.
Yes,
those are people who tend to be actively looking. And if you make a post on there, you'll find other people who are actively looking for a game.
100%. That is actually how I got back in to Shadowrun on playing online, like I mentioned earlier. Three Nugget in there in the chat room. He actually was one of the first people to respond to. I made a post on the LFG forum, the Looking for Group forum on Roll20, saying, hey, I want to run a Shadowrun game. I haven't played in a long time, and I want to run one. He was one of the people that responded. I got a group together, and it was good. I hear a lot of people say, when I hear people talk about this, that they can't find Shadowrun groups in Roll20. And Cassie, I think you're right. I think that they're trying to use that like tool that is on there to look for open games, you know?
It's neat, but it tends to be people set them open and forget about them versus people who set them up there and then are actively looking.
Yeah.
But if you post in the Roll20 chat, people are actively looking in there. So jump in there, and then a GM will probably, you know.
Well, the thing about it is, and this can apply, and here's another tip if you're looking for... So to give it a little context and kind of like segue a little bit away from the from ShadowNet and RunnerHub, maybe we can come back to it, but those are really awesome, as we've said, for what they are, for their they have a large community that's a little bit different than your home game. You've got pickup groups, you've got this shared world, all that kind of stuff. You're probably going to meet up with tons of different people, and that's awesome. But if you're really into and looking for that campaign style, that home, you know, gaming group feel, and you still want to, you still need to do it or want to do it online, then go to places like Roll20's forums. Go to the Shadowrun forums, forums.shadowrun.com. They have a looking for group thing there. I know that people find groups there all the time. Now, here's the thing. You're not, if you just casually go on places like this, and this applies to Roll20 too, if you just casually go on there and look for people who are running a game and looking for players, you're going to have a tough time. And I think that's part of that Roll20's tool problem. You need to put yourself out there and say, hey, I want to play a game. Is anybody need a player? Is anybody running a game? Or is anybody else interested? Because other people are like you. Other people are looking, and you know, you will find people.
The hazard you're going to run into, though, going to the role. I recommend going to the role and giving it a shot, but the hazard you will run into is all the normal ones you'll find in a home game. Like, somebody probably won't want a GM, and then you finally find a GM. Mm-hmm. Or if you're lucky to find a GM who's looking for players, you're going to run into, you know, scheduling, people on time, people not showing up.
Like,
all of that kind of normal home game stuff. Where one of the real advantages of ShadowNet or RunnerHub is those exist whether or not you're there.
Yeah. Well, a lot of home games kind of come out of the net too. Like people, what you tend to find is people will, there's people that have like infrequent schedules that can only play maybe once or twice a month or at weird times and they're never the same. But a lot of people have set schedules. And what happens is you'll find you'll be applying to the same runs with other people and be like, hey, I'm putting together an Exalted game or a home Shadowrun game.
Sure.
You get people for that within the community. These are people that you've ran other games with. You're like, okay, this person fits the same schedule. And that's nice. It's like an ancillary like bonus of being part of the communities.
Well, yeah, you're definitely getting in there. You're playing Shadowrun with a bunch of different people and you're meeting people. I mean, come on.
Yeah.
Yeah. And you meet people around the world. Like, it's kind of fun. I know one time I play a character who is he's Chinese American and he knew Cantonese, and I was on a table with a GM who was fluent in Cantonese. So when I put in like the emoji that I'm swearing at somebody in Cantonese, he actually starts doing it for me.
That's funny.
That's great. That's awesome.
So I hadn't thought about that angle, Justin, and that's a really good point. So I think I would suggest to anybody who's listening to this and you're struggling with finding a group to game with, finding ways to play Shadowrun online, you're getting tired of tuning into this show every other week to get your Shadowrun fix. You need more. definitely head on over to Reddit and check out ShadowNet. Check out RunnerHub. Get in some games and meet people and stuff like that. But again, like we were talking about with Roll20 and other places, you can go on there too, post saying you're looking for people. Here's something that I don't think a lot of people think about. You can get a group of people together, like four or five people, all who want to play, who don't want a GM, and you can go onto forums and say, hey, we've got a group. And does anybody want a GM for me? You can do that too.
Oh, yeah.
The GM does not have to be the one who makes the group.
Oh, yeah. A lot of the and doing it in Roll20 and the LFG things, it was vice. It was either way. I've done it both ways, where I'm the GM looking for players, or, hey, I've got an entire group. We just need a GM.
Yeah.
And you can find those people.
Mm-hmm. And either way, Roll20 is a thing because, do you guys on ShadowNet and RunnerHub
play on Roll20? Right?
Yeah.
Like, yeah, you guys use Roll20.
Roll20 is a great platform.
Mm-hmm.
We only have two requirements, really, to play on the net, and that's you have to use Discord because we use that for voice. We have all our voice rooms, and all the runs are done through there, and Roll20 because all the runs are done on Roll20.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, Roll, and for those who are listening who aren't familiar, Roll20, maybe should have said this when we first brought it up, but Roll20 is a web-based virtual tabletop platform. You get on there and you have a shared tabletop that everybody who's logged in can all view. You can manipulate like little tokens for NPCs and that represent your player and represent objects. You could throw maps on there and everybody can manipulate this tabletop and everybody sees it being manipulated in real time. So it's a way for you to go ahead.
Roll20.net.
Yes. Thank you.
Roll20.net.
Sorry, everything's .com to me. So
You guys should do like an entire episode on Roll20, just like what how to, you know, do all that stuff on there.
Oh, I would love to do that.
It's fantastic, especially
there's so much
I love the
depth.
Macro system.
Yeah, mm-hmm. There's so much depth to Roll20, and like I bought this like Shadow Pax map set, which was like just these cyberpunk little tokens
that
you kind of move around and build your own maps. And coming that from like first and second edition Shadowrun.
Yeah.
Like building the Matrix maps, I was like,
oh, well, especially with the crunch, like Roll20 is hands down the great. Like Cliff on the actual play was getting a little bit tired of alchemy because it was so tedious to do, but then I showed him like how to do macros, and
yeah.
I don't know if he'll still keep doing them, but yeah, like macroing out some of those things.
Yeah, and that's what Alex, you were saying that you're a big fan of the macros, and that's to me that's the strength of Roll20 in its virtual tabletop. So is the whole macro system.
I love the macro system. You can automate so much of the rolling. You can even have it prompt you for your numbers to input and what to label your roll as. Mm-hmm. You can have inline rolls. you can do all kinds of stuff. There's actually, in the table that I use for my old 4E home games, there is a macro that automatically calculates your grenade scatter for you.
Nice. Yeah. Yeah. See, talk about an intimidating, crunchy system like Shadowrun. If you have the gumption, like, you only have to learn how to do a thing one time, and then you just write a macro that remembers how to do it for you. I mean, even multi-step processes like spirit immunity. Yeah.
Spirit immunity, trying to figure out that math, like, bugged me so much that I wrote a macro for it. And now it just tells me.
Spellcasting is the first thing that pops into my head. You know, it's a multi-step process, or even just shooting a gun. Like, it's a multi-step process. You can write a macro that you click the button once and it pops up and says, okay, pick a force, pick a, you know, whatever. And it prompts you for all these different parts so that you won't forget. You can have it even have you roll drain for you after the fact, and then you never have to remember it again.
Well, there's some fun stuff the GMs can do too if you really want to get to playing with your table. Is you can make like tables and then a macro that will randomize things. So you see this used a lot more in D&D of like random loot tables.
Sure.
But I've also used it in Paranoia to do random drug tables, and I've used it in Shadowrun if you've ever ran in a mana storm and somebody casts a spell and I make them roll like a d6 to gamble on what's happening in somebody's turn.
Nice. So, yeah.
Like first spell they cast, they summon the Wild Hunt.
Also, I threw a screenshot in chat of the Roll20 table I was on last night, actually, in a RunnerHub game. So you can get an example of some of the fun things.
I've seen a lot of it.
If you have a premium account, you can even like make custom like character sheets. So if you're playing with the same people week in and week out, you can have their characters pretty much built in, and you really don't have to do all that much figuring out. You'd be like, okay, I'm gonna fire. You click on the thing, and it pretty much fires the weapon for you.
I do that for mine, and it's great because there's even like API tools built in where you can, you know, make so subtract everybody's initiative when it gets to the bottom of the line, so you don't have to worry about doing that every time. Mm-hmm. And then, yeah, the screenshot that Ali shared here is like a GM has a table with the map of Seattle and a thing for like the decker to put up their stuff, and then all the random charts that you know you're going to use because you can't get through combat without looking at these charts.
Yeah.
Right? Like,
yeah.
Especially once you bring in grenades and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. So we've got the defense modifiers table, initiative, situational modifiers for combat, melee modifiers. Those decking tables are amazing, by the way. They're great for making it clear what the decker has going.
Oh. And now we're totally not even talking anymore about our communities. We've gone off on a Roll20 chant.
Roll20 is amazing.
I mean, we all use it for a reason.
Yeah, it's an important part of playing online. I don't think it's really a digression at all. Because
that's where all your games are going to be done.
Yeah.
That's true.
If you go to the net or the hub.
Yeah.
Yeah. Oh, I'd say one of the other things I should mention was I know RunnerHub used to have a YouTube channel, but a lot of GMs still stream. I assume ShadowNet, do you guys stream your runs every so often? I know it was always GM by GM for the hub.
It's very much GM by GM. Some of our GMs will stream every single run, and then when we do things like our Extra Life thing, which...
Yeah, that was a big thing you guys did.
Yeah, we do that once a year with Extra Life. It's a big thing, not just within Shadowrun, but like the nerd community in general. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And we do like a 72-hour stream-a-thon. But any big metaplot thing, we try to, like, because I've done a lot of metaplot runs, like we'll try to stream, but we don't have a dedicated YouTube channel.
Yeah. If you keep an eye over there, it can be fun to like catch one of those, and you can watch it in progress to see how they work.
Yeah, like we streamed all the stuff leading up to killing the governor of Seattle, Brackhaven.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, cool. Like, that's another good point. RunnerHub, you guys do have a YouTube channel that you put stuff up on, right?
Yep, I just threw it into the chat right there.
Yeah, and I'll add that link to the show notes too. So I think that's really, really great. So people who are looking to play online, I really do strongly point you guys in the direction of ShadowNet and RunnerHub on Reddit. If anything, it's a way to meet tons of other people who are into playing Shadowrun and want to play Shadowrun games online. You'll meet people. You'll find people who want to play. And anything you guys before we adjourn, any last minute things you want to make sure that people hear about your various communities? We started with Justin before, so I'll start with Alex this time about RunnerHub.
I guess what I'll mostly say is, you know, try it out. If you've ever had difficulty getting a home game to take off or getting online pickup games to take off, I would honestly say that I've had more sessions on most of my characters on the hub mm-hmm. than I have on any other platform. Mm-hmm. And nice. It's been a lot of fun. And, you know, don't be shy about trying it and ShadowNet. Give them both a shot. See how you like them.
Yeah.
Because if you want to play Shadowrun and you don't have an easy time fishing a group up, this takes a lot of that difficulty out of it.
Yeah, no kidding. And Justin, what about you?
Just to further expand on him, like, especially if you... We try to pride ourselves on being very open and welcoming to new people, even people that aren't necessarily like experienced with Shadowrun. Like, you can come in and especially like just get on our Discord. You don't have to have a character approved to come to our Discord, and we have channels set up just for ChargeN, and we will help you. Like, we have people that are like, at, you know, active in that group
right.
that will help you build the character you want to make. So you don't have to do, you know, be concerned with all of this, you know, minutia, and you can get into playing the character you want to play.
Yeah, I think that's awesome. I couldn't agree more. I would definitely point people in that direction for if they're looking for games to play.
Hey, we didn't really mention it, but that's how we all know each other. Basically, is I've GM'd for both of these two on the RunnerHub, yep. and then we've kind of stayed in contact through our separate communities.
Yeah, and then CASSIE introduced you guys to me, so. Yeah, well, that's yeah. awesome. Let's, here we go. Ah, that beautiful music means that we're winding down. You know, I would be remiss if I didn't mention that Mr. Justin here, he is, if you guys listen to the Complex Action Actual Play, he is the patron brains behind... everybody's favorite technomancer NPC Z Trip that I play. So I like that guy.
Yeah, I've liked him for a long time. That I have a lot of very fond memories with that character. Because we're first introduced in the setting back in late second edition, early third. I can't remember which one. I was very little, and I was still playing with my dad's Shadowrun group because that's how I got into it. Holy was my dad let he was him and his friends were kind enough to let me play, you know, back in like 1990, and when they were introduced, I made an otaku that was the son of my dad's character, who was a decker.
Yeah,
and that was Z-Trip, and I kind of continued to play him in different formats, and always a little bit different, and there's always a little bit of a different spin, but I've really enjoyed like the way that you've made him your own. And,
yeah, you've handed this beloved character off to the wild, fumbly hands that is your friendly GM Bobby over here, who's...
I'm just happy that even if you're not playing him as a character, that you have found some kind of like for technomancers. Because when I first started watching you on your Complex Action, there was a few people that would send questions about technomancers, and you're like, I don't know. I don't even want to get into that. And like, you found at least some way, even if it's not like rules wise, like, because I think technomancers are massively interesting characters.
Yeah, I've Z-Trip. I mean, I have to admit, Z-Trip has been a way for me to explore that because, you know, he's shaped, thinking about him as a character has shaped how I think about technomancers in general, as well as other characters on there. But thank you guys for coming on to the show. Alex, I'm sorry, I'm cutting you off. What were you saying?
No, I was just saying, technomancers are interesting dudes. They have a very unique perspective in the sixth world.
Indeed they do. Indeed they do. So thank you guys a ton for coming and talking to us about it. I think we talked a lot about great ways, your communities, to find ways to play online. Is there anything in particular that you guys would like to or want to plug, like events that are coming up or anything like that, that we haven't covered?
Yeah, we starting, I guess there's a few things with the ShadowNet. Like, we have a new meta plot that's starting in late January. So this is a good time to, if you want to get in, especially if you want a GM, you can get in, get your three games as a player, and start participating in our meta plot that's going to start and expand out. That's the big one. Yeah, just cool. Like a new meta plot starting.
Cool. Alex, anything else that we missed?
Actually, I want to plug virtually the same thing. The Runner Hub is in the middle of its own meta plot, which is the
nice.
Redmond Restoration Act arc. And
cool.
I don't want to give away too much about it, but it has been some of the most fun Shadow Runs I've been on, including that screenshot I gave of Roll 20s from last night. It was a job for Terra First to break out a freelance terrorist who got caught selling 7-7 to some people.
Oh, wow. Well, that is cool. You guys should check it out. We will be back in 2 weeks like we usually are in the new year. It'll be 2017 when we return, and we're finally going to be doing an episode on the new source book, Cutting Aces. We're going to dive in and talk all about that. Our guest is going to be the first returning guest. Kevin Zarnecki is going to be joining us again to talk about Cutting Aces. So if you're interested in that, make sure you check it out. Cassie, anything you want to plug before we go?
I just want to still plug my Twitter, twitter.com/emeraldgrid, where I'm putting up random factoids and talking to people in character with my technomancer Rashada. Let's come check out random factoids.
Yeah, like awakened who dabble in tainted magic, such casting spells laced with negative emotions may attract twisted mentor spirits.
Yeah, who's ever cast a spell in anger? Think about who you're bringing with you.
Yeah, watch it. Clear your mind, and the rest will follow. That was a music reference. Anyway, I want to plug the cast party. I mentioned it, I think, earlier on January 2nd. If you're listening to the show, it'd be just a couple of days. It'll be Monday, January 2nd. We're having our next cast party for the Complex Action Actual Play. This is going to be a good one. Throwback, our new cast member, Decker, is going to be joining us for that and talking about his character. We're also having our first guest join us. Is going to be James O'Neill, one of our patrons. He's going to be joining us to get the chance to talk to us live on the show and be on the podcast. So we're really excited about that. You can, if you want to contact us on the show, you can tweet us at Six World Podcast. That's the number 6 World Podcast. You can email us at theshow@sixthworldpodcast.com, or just check out our website, sixthworldpodcast.com, where you can submit questions or check out things going on Patreon, where you can get all sorts of cool thank you rewards for helping support the show. Our outro music, which you're about to hear in just a second, is a little tidbit from Johnny Nuclear and the Meltdowns. Great Shadowrun inspired music, and our logo artwork is done by David McDermott. We're in love with that, so I have to mention him. But from me, from Cassie, and our awesome guests this episode, Justin and Alex, thank you guys for listening, and bye bye. Say goodbye, everyone.
Bye. Peace.
Goodbye, everyone.
Bye. No! I do that every time. I have to mark the here. Let me stop, guys. If you've been here before, you know this is about to happen. I'm stopping the stream and starting it again. Don't panic.
Panic.